Kevin Stefanski is saying the predictable thing on behalf of one of his players. He's making the same case that Mike McCarthy or Dan Quinn would make for Michael Parsons, the same case that Mike Tomlin would make for TJ Watt. It's predictable. It's understandable. It goes with the territory. It's really a headline if Kevin Stefanski starts saying, you know what, I think TJ Watt is a more viable candidate for defensive player of the year than Myles Garrett. But he's absolutely right in everything he says. Look, somebody's got to say it. Somebody's got to say it. He's absolutely right. And there was a time where I had Myles Garrett pegged as maybe an MVP candidate. Then they lost two games in a row against the Broncos and the Rams, and some of that steam came out. But now they've won two in a row. And I don't know what's going to happen the next 3 weeks. They win the division. Maybe Myles Garrett gets an MVP vote from me. Maybe he gets onto the top five on my ballot. But defensive player of the year, yes, that's a very real possibility, even though he's currently not the betting favorite. The betting favorite for now is Micah Parsons at minus 110. Myles Garrett next on the list at plus 165. Myles Simmons.
Well, I also, as much as I love Myles Garrett and I think he's great, I do think he is the best defensive player in the league right now. I don't know if it's really fair to say. I don't think it's close. And yes, Kevin Stefanski is going for his guy, and that's exactly what he should do. But, I mean, you can look around the league and see the way guys influence and affect things defensively. I mean, Micah Parsons, obviously, the Dallas Cowboys defense didn't have that great a performance, but that's another guy where you see it every single snap. You know, the Jaguars, Josh Allen, another guy, Danielle Hunter for the Vikings. I mean, these guys, they've played really, really, really well. But Myles Garrett, I think the types of things that he's been able to do over the course of this season and the leadership he's been able to show, the fact that he's still been able to make plays despite being held on basically every single play, which is why he criticized the officiating the way he did last week. I mean, it really, really, really is impressive. And, you know, when you are a defense that had the struggles that they did last year with Joe Woods as the defensive coordinator, you bring in Jim Schwartz. This is the kind of stuff that I thought we might see from Myles Garrett, where they did make some more investments along the defensive line. And guys like Darius Smith, you know, you bring in other guys like Shelby Harris, and it makes things that much easier for Myles Garrett to get those one-on-one opportunities, even though most of the time he's still going to get doubled. But he's taken his game to another level, right? And I felt like that could be the case, and it has been this year. And it's part of why the Browns are now 9-5 and look like they are going to make it to the playoffs for the second time in Kevin Stefanski's tenure, despite all of the crap that they've had to go through with injuries this year. It really is remarkable.
Four starting quarterbacks this year. Mm-hmm. And getting 38-year-old Joe Flacco off the couch when others foolishly had ignored him, it still is amazing to me that no one had called him sooner. He's done a great job. They get to the playoffs. And let's pivot to Stefanski, because we spend so much time talking about MVP. We don't talk much about Coach of the Year. And Coach of the Year, I've always explained it this way. It is the coach whose team best exceeds the generally accepted expectations entering the season. You expect them to be a Super Bowl contender. They are a Super Bowl contender. You're not Coach of the Year. That's why Bill Belichick, right, I think, only ever got it the year that they went undefeated. But the sweet spot is new coach, new team, non-playoff team, becomes playoff team. That's how you get in the conversation. Shane Steichen of the Colts, D'Amico Ryans of the Texans, Kevin Stefanski a few years ago with the Cleveland Browns, his first year, 2020, turned around a non-playoff team, took them to the top of the stack. And Stefanski languishing at 15-1, down there with Zach Taylor behind John Harbaugh. There's only one guy on that graphic who's had four starting quarterbacks this year, and it's Stefanski. I don't know whether it's because he's 1-1 or whether we don't expect much out of the Browns. The Browns is the Browns. I don't get it. His odds should be better. I mean, again, and I always wrestle with recommending what people should do with their money. If you're going to bet anyway and you're looking for something to bet on, if you've got your gambling money set aside, if you got your gambling money over here and you already have your limits on what you're going to spend and what you're willing to lose, then maybe think about, if you're looking for value, think about Stefanski. I'm not saying go out and affirmatively make a bet when you otherwise weren't going to. Oh, I got to go bet. Florio said Stefanski is good value. But if you're already going to do it anyway, those odds are enticing to me because Stefanski, I think, should be higher on that list than he is.
I think Stefanski should be way higher. You know, way, way, way higher. He's like MacGyver as a head coach right now. I mean, look at what he's done. You know?
You don't know about anything from the 80s. How can you say proudly, you don't know anything about Back to the Future, right? You don't know anything about the 80s, and you're going to make a MacGyver drop on me? Are you kidding me? Get out of here with that. You know all about the 80s. You just try to yank my chain.
I know plenty about the 80s. I don't know much 80s movies, but I have to admit I stole that one from my mom because she obviously is a very big Browns fan living in Cleveland. So she made that reference when we were talking last night. But I think what he's been able to do is basically put a team together with shoestrings, gum, a paperclip. You know, I mean, look at what he did on Sunday. I mean, they have 4 of 5 offensive line starters out of the game, and somehow they are still able to do things enough in the fourth quarter where Joe Flacco looks like an elite quarterback throwing that pass down the field to Amari Cooper in a spot where, I mean, I don't know how he fit it between those three defenders, and they still do it, right? You get the pass off to David Njoku down there when you're at third down. You've got to make sure that you get this drive, continue to go, and he makes the catch on the left side, and then he gets you into field goal range. I mean, what Kevin Stefanski's done with this team, winning games with 4 different quarterbacks, has been so, so, so impressive. And I don't understand why there's not more conversation for him as coach of the year. But I got to tell you, I mean, being from Cleveland, yeah, you got to kind of temper things a little bit because you never know what's going to happen until it happens. But if the Browns go to the playoffs, they win 10, 11 games this year, or if they happen to win all their last three, and they, especially if they win 12, there is no argument against Kevin Stefanski being coach of the year, in my opinion. I mean, I don't know that we've seen something like this where a team plays 4 quarterbacks and still looks like they could possibly win a playoff game, in large part because of the defense. And I don't think you can also discount the decision for Kevin Stefanski to go out and get Jim Schwartz to be his defensive coordinator. I mean, is there a better assistant hire that has happened over the offseason into this year? I don't think so. So a lot of stuff has gone right for Kevin Stefanski, and he deserves a lot of credit.
Who was available for anyone and wasn't working? It was all, you know, Vic Fangio and Isiro Evero and Brian Flores and, oh, hey, Jim Schwartz. Oh, and it was one of those things, like, when it happens, like, hey, you know what? It kind of makes sense. Mm-hmm. And right out of the gates, one of their first games, I talked to Myles Garrett afterward, and he's going on and on about everything Jim Schwartz is doing. They're moving him around. They're doing what they can to maximize Myles Garrett. Hi, it's Mike Florio. Thanks for watching PFT on YouTube. Hit subscribe for the latest news and analysis from Pro Football Talk.